Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
All right.
So, good morning.
Good afternoon.
It's time to have a terrific panel here. First of all, I should thank the Politicon.
What's that? Your mic's not working.
Okay. Here we go. Now can you hear me?
No.
I can hear you fine.
Hello.
Can I hear you?
That's the okay. All right. We ready? Sound?
No.
All right. Well, hopefully you can hear me because they seem to have lost the sound.
You want us to switch and you? I think my mic is on. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. You want to put us off and then come through?
Hold on. Help, as Dick Cheney once said, help is on the way.
Any Hillary supporters in here?
Woo-hoo!
Bernie supporters?
Yeah!
Trump? All right. Security?
Gary Johnson.
Gary Johnson?
Oh,
double Trump.
Sounds like. All right. We're back in business.
There we go.
All right. Thank you. You guys can hear me now?
Yes.
So, all right. Thank you, Bill, for that excellent filling. All right, so we have a terrific panel here this afternoon. All right. No? Still low?
No.
Take it out of your pocket.
It's on.
There. Don't put it in your pocket.
See, can you hear me now?
Yes.
All right, good. Okay, so with all of our technical troubles, we have a panel of... Good, all right. First up, President Barack Obama's Director of Speechwriting from 2009 to 2013, named by Time Magazine as one of the most 100 most influential people in the world. Please welcome Jon Favreau. To his right, logistically, if not ideologically, a man who was President Obama's Deputy National Press Secretary, one of the top message strategists in the nation. He is now the Managing Director of SKD Knickerbocker's LA office, Bill Burton. Our next panelist is an expert on national security, having served in the Nixon, Ford, and Reagan administrations. She's a columnist for FoxNews.com and a Fox News national security analyst. Please welcome Katie McFarland. Also joining us, someone who was not only one of the featured speakers at the initial Politicon last October, but is an actor, a singer, 2014 congressional candidate in North Carolina, and a leading spokesman for the LGBT community. Please welcome Clay Aiken. Also with us, the senior political correspondent for Mike, the website Mike, a journalist who has covered the last four presidential races. Please welcome Celeste Katz. We're going to talk about the art of campaign strategy. So I want to start. You're sitting at your desk Monday morning, phone rings, and it's Robbie Mook and John Podesta on the other end of the line. And they want you to come in and give them an outsider assessment of their assets and liabilities at this point in the Hillary Clinton campaign. What's working and what isn't working? We'll do the same exercise we did with Paul Manafort and I guess Ivanka Trump, who looks like the power behind the throne. But let's start with Robbie and John Podesta. They call you up, what do you tell them? What's working for Hillary Clinton now, and what should they be worried about?
I think that she has a great organization so far. I think that they ran a primary that was, I mean, obviously Hillary Clinton's campaign in 2008 had a lot of problems with structural organization, field. They famously, didn't figure out the caucuses, and that's how we sort of ran up the delegate numbers on them back in 2008. And I think took those lessons to heart during this primary, and obviously they had a strong challenge from Bernie Sanders, but I think they fended off that challenge in some part because of the really strong organization that they built in the states that they needed to. So I think that's going really well. I think her challenge now is, and she's figured out how to attack Donald Trump, and she's figured out sort of the negative frame on Donald Trump. The tough part is eventually she's going to need to get voters to support her and to go to the polls to support her positive vision for the future. she's laid out that vision a bunch of times, but it's hard to get that vision covered because Trump dominates the news, and she can only dominate the news when she talks about Trump. So at some point, Hillary's going to be out there offering policy prescriptions, talking about her vision for the country, and actually breaking through and getting that covered, but it's hard when she's not just hitting Trump all the time.
So let me give you a second. KT, what would be the assets and liabilities if you were, if the, you know, Clinton campaign somehow were asking you, what is...
I'm going to get a story. They're not going to call
me. What is working for them now, and what should they be worried about?
I think that whether it's whoever the establishment candidate, and I think Hillary will have a very difficult time saying that she's not the establishment candidate. As I look at American politics, it's the candidate, yes, but it's often the mood of the country at the time. And when those two are in sync with each other is when you have a successful candidacy. I think that the United States every 40 years goes through a throw-all-the-bums-out mode. We started doing it in 1776, where we got rid of the British. We did it again in 1820 when Andrew Jackson got rid of the Virginia-landed aristocracy. We did it during the Civil War. We did it in 1900 with Teddy Roosevelt. We did it during the World War II. We did it with Reagan. I think we're in another one of those moments now, and the vote in Britain this week, the Brexit vote, which confounded the pollsters and confounded the political establishment on both sides of the Atlantic, Republican and Democrat, I think that that is the mood of the American people. And that's why Bernie Sanders, that's why Donald Trump, whether you like these people or not, they are resonating with the part of the population which feels that it's been disenfranchised. So my advice to Hillary Clinton was, I'm not really sure how she breaks through that, because I think that the country is not in sync with who she is as a person, and I don't know that she can reinvent herself. I think her best strategy is to stand back and hope Trump falls.
Celeste, what do you think?
As far as, I mean, I'm watching this, you know.
From watching this as a journalist, what would you say is working for Hillary Clinton at this point, and what are her biggest liabilities?
I think some of what Hillary Clinton is doing now is different than what she did in 08. But I think in 08, what I saw out there traveling around, it was a very different mood. I mean, there was not just this, you know, this big battle with Barack Obama at the time, you know, the guy who could be the first African-American president versus the woman who could be the first female president. I think that, you know, she's changed a little bit, and I think it's been hard for her to recapture that excitement in a way, but at the same time, I think it's smart for her to not try to relive the 08 campaign because she lost. So that would be sort of a bad move. But as far as how she treats Donald Trump, and that's the real problem, I mean, do you pay too much attention to him and give him too much credit? Do you ignore him and just, you know, somebody's like throwing rocks at your car, you know, move your car. I mean, it becomes kind of a problem. So she's caught in this very difficult position, and the press watching her is, you know, very, very attuned to how she's going to make a decision about how to finally face down this sort of Trump phenomenon.
Clay, as a former candidate, how would you say, how are they doing in defining this race, defining themselves?
Well, let's talk about how qualified I am to speak on this. Very.
We both ran.
And lost.
We ran and lost.
I can only speak as a armchair politics viewer. You know, I think that what KT was talking about is probably the truth. Donald Trump doesn't need to say anything intelligent. Donald Trump doesn't need to talk about policy because he just has to talk. He has to be the anger personified of these folks. And so, what's working for him? Seems like most everything is working for him at this time. Now he may have had a ceiling. He was supposed to have that 15% ceiling, and then he had then it went above that, and then it was 30. I mean, as a Democrat, I sort of hope he has one at 45. But we saw what happened in England, so in UK. So I just am going to echo what KT said.
Let's come back to UK in a minute. Bill, let me ask you. Let's move over to the Trump side and add what you want to say. One thing that's striking about Trump is that there's been no analytics. There was no polling. He's kind of skeptical, if not scornful, of many of the techniques of modern campaigns. The Obama campaign of both 08 and 12 took to the ultimate level, you know, redundant data sources trying to figure out how to target voters. He's basically kind of said all of that is scamming candidates and is it really necessary. What do you think about, I mean, what is the experiment that is going on here? Is he placing the wrong bet by downplaying all of these modern tools?
Well, I think the thing Trump should be most worried about is that if you look at the primaries, I hate to say this in front of you because you know the numbers all so well, I can't lie. He mostly underperformed where the polls had him. And I think that that's largely because he didn't have an army of people who were helping to turn out voters. He didn't have labor unions. He didn't have churches. He didn't have that like network of folks who were using the data that was available in order to get voters to the polls. In a 50-state general election, that's a real problem. Because a lot of these states, it's going to be very close. You look at a place like North Carolina. Indiana now looks like it's going to be close. You look at Ohio. Like in these places, it's going to be important to have a dedicated source of information and people who are pushing people out. So I think that that's a major disadvantage he has. And then just to add to what John said about Hillary Clinton, I think the structural kind of disadvantage that Trump has in terms of money should help her with her message problem, right? I think that she really only does get attention when she talks about Donald Trump, but she has so much more money in the bank where she can communicate with voters through paid media ads that she has an ability to go directly to voters and help build the case for why they should be excited about voting for her, not just voting against Donald Trump. So I think that's an asset that she has that I think we'll see them put to use.
I'll come back to the money segment. Can I just follow up and ask you, explain a little bit about what the cutting edge looks like in terms of voter contact now. When you're the Obama campaign and you're trying to squeeze out every last vote in Ohio, what does that look like at this point, or the Clinton campaign in 2016? What are they doing? How are they modeling the electorate? How are they contacting people? What's kind of the disparity between that side and what Trump hasn't, at least at this point, been doing?
Well, it's a mix of old and new methods of getting voters out. On the one hand, you've got all this new data, and the data is so intensely personal about individuals, not just demographics. People talked about how Karl Rove, in 2000, helped to figure out how to micro-target voters based on a whole bunch of series of variables about their lives. Do they like golf? Do they watch cooking shows, things like that. And so like they had this cable program that helped Bush get 500,000 fewer votes than Al Gore but still become president. Now, you can take that same information, you're not just looking at people precinct by precinct or demographic by demographic, but you can link up the information about a voter, how many times they voted, and connect it with their internet activity. And so the voter file and the internet and their internet activity is linked up in such a way that you can target ads at individuals and know who's looking at the ads and who's not looking at the ads. So you take all that information, and then you feed it out to your network of people who are out there pushing voters out to the polls. So you've got, I mentioned before, labor unions, churches, all these different groups. But like President Obama, he built on top of that this My Barack Obama network. And so you had individuals precinct by precinct all around the country who are pushing voters out to vote. Donald Trump's strategy right now is not that. It is a different thing, where he's just trying to win this campaign through speeches and press conferences, sometimes in Scotland, and it's a problem.
After the 2012 campaign, I asked Jeremy Burton, he's the field director for the Obama campaign, in a swing state, what percentage of the people who voted for you did you think you can, by name, as an individual, and they said based on their modeling, 95%. They could identify 95% of who voted for by name. So the question really becomes, and we have seen from the beginning, KT, Trump used the mass media in a way, as a broadcast, dominated mass media, as John said, in a way that we have not really seen from any candidate during the primary or general. To what extent do you think that free media, that omnipresent, overwhelms either money advantages and paid media or organization? How has the balance shifted?
Oh, we won't know the answer to that until after the election. I would add to that, though, not only has he dominated the airwaves, and I know I work at Fox News, and I'm sure that you at CNN, when Donald Trump comes on, the ratings spike. And it makes sense for any of the networks, any of the radio shows, to have Donald Trump on as much as possible for their own self-interest. The other thing, though, I think is an interesting phenomenon is if you look back and sort of who were the presidents who mastered the media of their moment, FDR during the fireside chats in World War II, the medium of the moment, the way that you connected personally to the American people was through the radio, and he mastered that. Reagan mastered television, so that people, and they never met Ronald Reagan, they may never go to a Ronald Reagan rally, but they had a personal connection to him because of his background in the media and in Hollywood. He knew how to use that, how to use the camera to somehow speak directly to people. If you talk to people who, I guess if anybody is here who is alive and cognizant politically in 1980, you know, we all felt that Reagan was talking to us. It was a very intimate and personal connection. Trump has done the same thing. He's done it with Twitter. When you read those Twitter feeds, anybody a follower of the real Donald Trump? Okay, when you see those Twitter feeds, you know that's him. You don't think it's like 20 staff people who have sort of decided which is the right word here that we're going to use. They haven't poll tested that day. You know that's Donald Trump, just tap, 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 tap. And so, we laugh. But in fact, that's how he's reached, I think the Twitter feed up today was 9 million people. The people who are reading that, they're thinking, oh yeah, he's talking to me. I know that's Donald Trump. That's not the legion of campaign consultants that Hillary has. He's talking directly to me. So I think that we don't know the exact, you know, what are the ramifications of that, but I would think if you talk to all the political candidates, who do you think is talking to you, whether you like what he's saying or not? He's talking directly to you through the Twitter feed. And it's free.
Here's worth noting here. To win the general election, roughly 65 million Celeste.
Yeah, his mic is going in.
Yeah, all right, so hopefully this will help. Yeah. Celeste, let me ask you this. Go to this point. We are seeing more pervasive coverage than ever before. Cable wall to wall. As KT mentioned, the ability to reach people directly through social media and internet sites proliferated. What is the balance of power, you think, between paid media and free media in shaping campaign dialogue? How do you think that is evolving?
Well, I think that, I mean, certainly if you look at Donald Trump, he got to where he is today because of earned media, free media, because all of us have, you know, been covering him wall to wall since he first came down the escalator and, you know, decided to make America great again, and that's fine. But I think that only goes so far. I mean, the next big free media event is going to be the debates. And I think that everybody here, I mean, if you're here, I presume you're going to be interested in seeing, you know, that 10 rounds of throwdown between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. I think that the interesting thing about how the media game has been played in this election is that it is probably the best example to date, and it will keep going this way, of campaigns trying to get around the media, away from the media. The media is a filter. I mean, you know, you go to a Donald Trump event, and he spends like 5 minutes talking about what he thinks and 20 minutes talking about how much I suck and all my friends, you know, in the press suck because we suck.
Right.
And so they don't want to go through that filter. And also, it's very popular to say you don't like the press because, you know, we are horrible. Hi, I'm horrible. So, but, you know, in that way, but that's very targeted. He's tapping into something. He's tapping into, you know, all this anger in the United States. And one thing people are angry about is the media. Somehow, the media is not telling you the truth. The media is making stuff up. They're hiding things from you. They're working for the big corporations, so they're working for the special interests. So Trump has been able to capitalize on that. The Clinton campaign traditionally has been very cautious, very guarded, very protected. You know, who do they let in? What do they say to them? When do they say it? You know, has it been tested? Has it been polled? Has it been, you know, what, held up to the light and all that stuff? So I think the big story about media in this campaign, whether, you know, especially in earned or free media, is how much the campaigns are sort of fighting press coverage.
John, can I ask you a way in this, which is, you know, at this point, if you look at the swing states, the spending imbalance right now is Hillary Clinton and her allies have spent $25 million in this for their advertising, and Donald Trump has spent zero.
Right.
And it won't be zero forever, but by the end, there's probably going to be a significant imbalance looking at the fundraising. How important is that kind of targeted advertising relative to control of the daily news cycle and the daily news debate? What's more important now, particularly in these swing states and presidential politics?
So I think it remains to be seen how effective advertising really is, and we're gonna test this on perhaps the biggest scale we've ever tested in this election, because Donald Trump's not going to have much paid. You're right, he's going to have somebody, he's not going to have nearly as much as her, and she's going to have a ton. So we'll find out on election day. But I think going back to him dominating the media, I think you could argue that Donald Trump, his social media presence and his saturation of the media, has at least hurt him as much as it's helped him.
It's at least what?
Hurt him as much as it's helped him. Because, I mean, he is right now sitting at between 35 and 40% in national polls. That is historic lows for any major party nominee. He's the most unlikable candidate that's ever run for president of the United States. Hillary doesn't have great favorability either. She's not too far behind him, but he's out there way ahead. And so I totally agree. Like, I hate when Twitter accounts that are supposed to be a candidate are, like, run by the campaign. I think you need to, if you're going to run for office, you need to be communicating with people directly. You shouldn't be handled that much. You shouldn't be over-scripted. I can say this as a speechwriter. So I think it's good to, you know, be yourself and to say things that are true to you. But, you know, after Orlando, when Donald Trump's first tweet is, appreciate the congrats on radical Islamic terrorism, or after Brexit, when he lands in Scotland and tweets like, everyone's so excited here, you know, like, Scotland voted to remain. He hurt himself a lot with those comments. And those are not even ideological comments. It wasn't even left or right. And I think the one thing that we all have to keep in mind is the general electorate and their preferences and their views are far, far different from the Republican electorate. So I think in a crowded field of 17 Republican candidates, Donald Trump did very well standing out in the crowd by dominating media. I don't think you get that same advantage when it's just one-on-one.
90% of the primary electorate is white. In the general election, it'll probably be 70%. But Clay, that's another angle.
Why don't you use my mic?
Billy, just speak right.
No, it's not working. I gave it to you. Yeah, we're going to this one. All right, Clay, let me ask you. You ran 2014. You know, we are seeing a kind of a decline in split ticket balloting up and down the ballot. You know, from the 70s to today, voters are much more likely to parallel the way they vote for president and the way they vote for down ballot offices. How difficult was it for you to make this a personal race and not just a generic, do you want a Democrat or Republican in control of Congress? Could you make it about the two of you, or was it really fundamentally about the two parties?
Well, in my particular race, it was, for the voters, it was about the parties. For me, we didn't have as much difficulty making it personal because the reason I ran was more because of my view of the inadequacy of the incumbent.
Yeah.
So it was about personal.
For the voters.
For the voters, I mean, I also ran in a district that was R12. And was very gerrymandered to be incredibly Republican. So I knew that it wasn't going to be ideologically a place where I could be. I was running in North Carolina, too, where Kay Hagan at the same time was also trying to run strong towards the middle in order to placate that swing vote in North Carolina. So ideologically, I didn't have to necessarily make it. I didn't make it too personal because I knew that I couldn't be far left. I do want to real quickly make a comment about Trump, just because I'm as embarrassed as I am to say it. I know him from doing his show. I mean, his earned media is instinctive. The reason he doesn't have this team around him is because he truly believes he knows better than everyone else, and this is a problem. I don't disagree with John that his issue has been that his earned media has hurt him just as much as it's helped him. But to KT's point, I think, you know, when you are spending all your money on paid media, and that's how you are getting your message across, if it is a year that's establishment versus anti-establishment, then won't, maybe this is a question instead of a statement, won't the voters who are anti-establishment see these ridiculous comments as being refreshing? I mean, the fact that he says something completely stupid, is it not refreshing that he is, I'm sorry, I think it's stupid. Well, is it not refreshing that it's authentic and not scripted? And so earned media gives him the opportunity to have something different every day, to respond very quickly, whereas paid media is sort of the same old, where you're going to get the same ad that I'm tired of, I've seen it 15 times, it keeps popping up, so I don't know if that helps.
John, I do want to ask you to kind of assess as a speechwriter. I mean, Trump is really the opposite end, kind of in temperament, the opposite end of the spectrum of President Obama in this way.
Right.
Who's very precise, he's a lawyer, he will sit there, he will edit the speech. Trump is like Jack Kerouac typing all night on the paper. He's just standing up there, he's like kind of a beat poet of politics. a towel from a podium. What, I mean, this is, you know, we have, I mean,
it's the opposite end of the spectrum. Talk about kind of the merits of two kind of styles of communication.
I decided to work for Barack Obama primarily because, to me, he seemed the most authentic person in politics that I've come across, right? And the thing with Obama is, though, he says what he wants to say. It's not like I sat there writing speeches and, like, leaning them into the teleprompter. He had a lot to say about every single major speech we ever delivered and wrote a lot of them himself. So he's put a lot of... He was himself.
Did you get to leave early on those days?
Yeah, right. Yeah, no, yeah. Went to the bar. No, so, like, it was from Obama's heart and his head a lot of his speeches, but he took the time to think over exactly what he wanted to say. And, look, sometimes he would add more policy detail and more, you know, than any of us wanted. The message people just wanted, like, a quick soundbite. He was like, no, we got to carefully think through this argument. So I do think you can be authentic and true to yourself and tell it like it is and still prepare for what you're going to say. I don't think that's what
happened. All right. What is it about it? Clearly Trump's style as a communicator is different than almost any politician, political leader, or person. What would you describe as kind of what separates him from the way other politicians talk to the public?
I mean, he talks about, look, anybody here from New York? Okay. You know, a guy's from Queenstown, right? Right. He sounds like he's a guy from Queens. I mean, he sounds like...
I'm from Queens.
Okay, well, you obviously a lot of stuff. But Donald Trump Jr. says, my dad is a blue-collar billionaire. And that is how he sounds. I mean, as a woman, how many of you walk past a construction site? I mean, this was me 30 years ago. But walk past a construction site, guys gave you wolf whistles, right? I mean, we're offended. This is so terrible. Well, I guess it's all relative. Some of us thought it was that offensive. That's how Donald Trump sounds. He sounds like the guy that you hang around with. And he isn't scripted. And in a moment, like I said, in an environment now where it is definitely throw all the bums out. And it's not a Republican, it's not a Democrat thing, it's Washington versus the rest of the country thing, somehow Donald Trump has managed to sound like he's not the guy from inside the Beltway, whereas all the other Republican candidates in the primary and Secretary Clinton, they all sound like they're inside the cartel of Washington, and I think that's why he's been so effective.
But he doesn't sound like he's from inside the Beltway because
he's not from
no the idea what he's talking about. I think it's an establishment. It's here where it's throw the bums out or establishment versus non-establishment. I say if it is, then he may have an advantage. But, you know, I think at the end of the day, come November, as relatable as he is, voters in the United States are going to want someone who they're willing to have the nuclear.
Let me ask one specific manifestation of how that plays out for Bill first and then Celeste. I mean, you know, one of the ways this kind of question of expertise and competence and temperament could play out is in kind of the class divide around Donald Trump. I mean, because of the primary campaign that he ran, he's facing big, as John said, historically high unfavorable ratings among African Americans and Hispanics, approaching 90% unfavorable in each case, which requires him to do better, even better than Mitt Romney did among white voters. Romney won 59% white voters and he lost. So Trump has to drive up the white number. He scored very well among blue-collar whites in the primary, but he is lagging in polling among college-educated white voters who are the most probably, polling suggests, are the most attuned to these questions of preparation and competence. Just one last fact before I actually get to a question. No Democratic presidential candidate in the history of polling has ever won college-educated white voters. None, not even Lyndon Johnson. 1964, but in most polls today, including two this week, Hillary Clinton is now ahead among college-educated white voters. So is there a kind of a class separation in the response to Trump and the way that he is kind of presenting himself?
There's a lot of facts. But yes. I think yes among white voters in particular.
Yeah.
Because you do... It's hard to say that 30%, like, extract 30% of the electorate between black and brown voters and not make that part of the class conversation, right? Because you are talking about groups with lower levels of college education who Hillary Clinton is winning in huge numbers. But for Donald Trump, you know, he... I'll say the thing that keeps me up at night about Donald Trump...
Say that they don't care, you know,
Donald Trump being as mayor or whatever, they do not want to vote for Hillary Clinton, even to stop him. They believe in what Bernie Sanders says, and they cannot be convinced. And they say they will stay home, they will bring him in, they will vote for a third-party candidate like a Gary Johnson or a Jill Stein. They are fighting it out, and it will be hard for her to convince them, and I think the way they do it is through Bernie. And, you know, is he making it incredibly easy for her right now? Not exactly. I think we'll see, you know, after Philadelphia, or as we get closer to Philadelphia, how that plays out.
We're going to bring in the audience. You guys want to line up the microphones? Anybody want to ask a question? But while you do, let me ask one question to the panel. In the last couple of days, Brent Scowcroft, the National Security Advisor for George H.W. Bush, Richard Armitage, the Deputy Secretary of State for George W. Bush, and George W. Bush, and Hank Paulson, the Treasury Secretary for George W. Bush, all have endorsed Hillary Clinton. They're probably not the last prominent Republicans to do so. Does this matter to see elite foreign policy and national economic policy Republicans say that Trump should not be president? Will that have any effect on his support among Republican voters, KT?
Well, as a Republican who probably identifies with a lot of those people, no, I don't think it will. And, you know, Hank Paulson, you could make the argument he was one of the guys that brought on the economic crisis. And this echoes, there was a letter, or I don't know if you had followed it, but a couple of months ago where 50 foreign policy experts, yeah. Republicans, said, never Trump. Look, I think he wears that as a badge of honor. Say, are you kidding? Those are the guys who screwed up the Afghanistan war, they screwed up the Iraq war, they went into Libya. I, Donald Trump, want nothing to do with that foreign policy because it's been 15 years of a disaster in the Middle East.
Bill, if you could put these names on television in Republican-leaning suburbs, would it matter?
Absolutely, and I think it's for the reason that you pointed out about college-educated voters. A lot of folks who are right-leaning Republican, or right-leaning independents, or left-leaning Republicans are looking for permission to vote for Hillary Clinton or to not vote for the Republican nominee. Big names like those help to build that permission structure for voters.
Question.
Sure. I am wondering to what degree you may think the Bradley effect could play into the election this year. I mean, is there a question in your sort of expert mind of perhaps voters who will answer pollsters, no, of course I would never vote for Donald Trump, and go into the ballot booth and press that button?
Good question.
By the way, that was one of the reasons that Brexit was, the polls were all screwed up with Brexit, is that people felt that they, if their pollster asked them a question and they didn't want to look like a racist or bigot, so they said, well, I'm going to vote to remain in the European Union, and that's why it was almost 10 points off with the poll.
I think it's possible that there could be some of that, but that's where this organization that we were talking about, where, like, the Clinton campaign, if it's like the Obama campaign was in 2012 and 2008, will know almost to the person who their voters are, how, you know, getting them out to the polls. Like, look, if they turn out the Obama coalition, then it's over. And so you have to find a whole bunch of voters who voted for Obama twice who now will vote for Donald Trump. That's, at the end, that's what this comes down to. And I'm sure the Clinton campaign will be looking for those voters and those voters who are on the fence, and they'll know who they are in the states that they need to. So I think the get out the vote operation will be a little more sophisticated to sort of mitigate the possibility that may happen.
Over here.
I'm wondering if there's any information yet that's been gathered about how Donald Trump's presence as the presumptive Republican nominee is affecting or going to affect Republicans down the ticket, whether it be for Congress or governor or any other local races.
I'll tackle that a little bit. The long-term trend is that split ticket voting is in decline from the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the odds, it's declining every day. In the 26 states that voted both times for President Obama, Democrats now have 41 of the 52 Senate seats. In the 22 states that voted against him both times, Republicans now have 40 of the 44 Senate seats. And as Clay knows, it's hard to win in a Republican-leaning seat. There are very few mismatches anymore. And so if Clinton wins big, then it is going to be a huge challenge for Republicans in the Senate because they are defending 7 seats of their 11 in the states that voted both times for President Obama. By the way, so 80% of the seats in the states that voted both times for Obama are now Democratic. Over 90% of the seats in the states that voted both times against him are Republican. If you go back to Nixon and Reagan, it was only about 50%. So the correlation is getting tighter, and I think one way or the other, as it was in 2014 in Arkansas and in Louisiana hurting the Democrats, or it may be in states like Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Illinois this time helping them, the fate of the congressional candidates and the presidential candidate is much more tightly linked than it used to be.
I will say, however, that we're helping the House Democrats win some races around the country, and one of the things that we've seen in polling is that the more Paul Ryan is out there distancing himself from Trump, and the more key Republicans try to move away from him, it does help to give voters a sense that Trump and the congressional Republicans are not exactly the same. The trends that Ron is talking about are very hard to break from, so like that is the reality. But from, you can see it in the polls that voters are starting to say, well, you know, Renee Elmers is not Donald Trump, or she's a bad example, she lost.
Over here.
Yes, for 20 years, I watch as the press, who has a 6% to max 20% approval rating, less than Congress. You guys are totally oblivious. You can't understand why you have such a low approval rating when you shilled for Bill Clinton, you shilled, openly shilled for Obama, and now you're shilling for Hillary. And I don't know, I don't think you get it yet. My question is, if she's criminally indicted, I mean, you always attack Trump on style, you barely touch Hillary and her criminal acts. My idea of having a sexual predator,
okay,
and having an indictment, will you do a fair job in your reporting if she's criminally indicted, yes or no?
Yes, I think if she's criminally indicted, it will be news, yes. I think that is
I think watch Fox News.
I think it's interesting, though, the press thing. In a way, the Republican Party, I mean, obviously the establishment of the Republican Party, has come out, and many of them don't want Donald Trump, but in a way, I feel like that's their fault, because they spent 20 years trying to get people to believe, trying to get voters to believe that the media was lying, the media was biased, the media didn't give the facts. And then, when the media started fact-checking Donald Trump during the primary, and they needed the media to tell those voters that he was lying, they didn't trust him. And so, in a way, it's
so, Celeste, do you think that, you mentioned this before, do you think that, you know, skepticism or hostility toward the press among a part of the electorate is going to be a weapon for Trump, is going to be an asset for Trump?
Absolutely. I mean, I think that since the beginning, we have written about Donald Trump, just like any other candidate. I mean, I've covered, this is my fourth presidential, because I started, I became a reporter when I was 10 and everything. But the same way you'd cover a race for governor or mayor, somebody comes out and they make a statement in a speech, or you look back at their record and you just say, is this provably true or false? And then you run it, and then if something turns out to be false that they said is true, obviously I'm a jerk. Obviously I'm in the bag for the other side. I'm a bad person. Okay, it's okay to feel that way, but I think that Donald Trump will be, and has been, very, very smart about using that to, his benefit.
Let's bring it
up.
Here we go.
For Democrats who think Trump would be the ideal candidate for us to run against, what are the chances still of Trump not getting the nomination as more and more people start worrying about how bad his numbers are and how defeatable he looks?
I think it's not going to happen. I think he's got the nomination, and more likely what would happen is that as I said earlier, I think we're seeing tectonic plates shifting in the political landscape. More likely would be that he will bring in Republican, into the Republican Party, like the Reagan Democrats, and the people that you're talking about, the Republicans that you just mentioned, Ron, who will not be. So it's not, I think, and the question is he gain more than he loses more? So the question I would have, though, to you and any of you guys, especially you guys, do you think that Donald Trump can make a new impression on people? He's changed his campaign. You think it's now set the same way Hillary is? You know who Hillary is. She can't reintroduce herself. You don't think Donald Trump can reintroduce himself?
His campaign is changing a lot already. I mean, to the point about whether it's better to be, sort of freewheeling and unscripted or to be prepared. He's now pivoted to, delivering speeches off a teleprompter.
But if he does, if people's concern is that he's not presidential, if he's able to be presidential for 4 months, don't people then say,
Well, that's a really good, that's an empirical question. Let me ask you, you're talking about candidates, Trump with an unfavorable that's over 60, Hillary with an unfavorable that's in the mid to high 50s, the highest ever, you know, for the presidential candidates. How much room do they have? If you had a bet today on election day, how much lower could those unfavorables be if things go well?
Well, I'm sure John's got something hilarious to say about Trump reinventing himself. But I think the difference between Trump's negatives and Hillary's negatives are that she has a lot more room to grow than he does, in the sense that the polling still reflects a large number of Democrats who are Bernie supporters who tell pollsters they don't like Hillary Clinton. And I think that as time goes on and the more Trump attacks her and the more the stakes are really it's Trump or Hillary, I think that you'll see those numbers start to inch up. Plus, she's going to have a smart strategy to introduce herself to voters. But I just don't think Trump can have that same kind of movement, because mainly because he has no impulse control.
How much room does he have?
That's what I was going to say. I mean, look, we do have short memories in this country that get shorter with each election. And so if Trump turned it all around tomorrow and read nothing but scripted speeches and calmed down, didn't say anything crazy, didn't tweet anything crazy from now until November, you know, the problem he would still have is he'd be running against all of the other things that he said, because Hillary Clinton has $42 million already on hand to run all those ads and remind people of what he said. But the bigger problem, I think, is we have not seen any capacity for self-discipline from Donald Trump yet. And so every time he gives one of these speeches off the prompter, which, by the way, are not like the most normal speeches either. Right? Like, he says some, you know, he did accuse Hillary Clinton of murder in the last speech there, too. So that wasn't like a total reinvention. But I don't think he has the self-discipline to stay on script, because I think he thinks to himself, the reason people like me is because I'm not scripted. And so I've got to say these things because that's what got me this far. So every time his handlers tell him, stay on script, you see him sort of chafe again.
Let me bring in another question and you can respond. Go ahead.
Thank you. Back in 2004, when Bush beat Kerry and he was, you know, totally unfavorable candidate, a lot of people were deconstructing how have the Republicans been winning. And George Lakoff came up with the moral narrative that they've been duping the public. You know, they're the party of moral superiority. And every political consultant and pundit came along saying Democrats need to have a moral narrative, Democrats need to have a moral narrative. Everybody was on this bandwagon, and all of a sudden, here we are 10, 12 years later, and there is no moral narrative out there. And I'm wondering, is would that not be beneficial to take this election beyond a Hillary-Trump contest, and not an issue of personality, but rather a...
Let me challenge you on the premise. Isn't it possible that the idea of stronger together, that America works better as a diverse, inclusive society, which is, I think, becoming the central theme for Clinton, as opposed to painting Trump as someone who is about heightening division, isn't that a moral narrative?
Well, I don't think it's being really put out there. I think that what we're looking at is a dichotomy between the Republican authoritarian moral paradigm and the progressive altruistic moral paradigm. And I think it needs to be tied back into what are American values.
I mean, I think this is the challenge that I was talking about in the first question. Uh-huh. It, as Ron said, it is there. I read her speeches, Stronger Together, and like, I think it's hard to get that message out, right? Like, if I looked at both messages right now, I would not say that the progressive narrative is all about altruism. I would say that even more so than some of her economic stuff, it's about this is a country that's open and tolerant and pluralistic and stronger when we include everyone and inclusive. And like, that's very hard to get that covered when you're not, you know, taking a sledgehammer against Donald Trump in the same sentence. So but I noted that, like, that, I think that is the message also that you'll see President Obama deliver when he's on the trail. And when he spoke after Orlando and sort of took on Trump, not by name, but by what he was proposing then, his message there is, I think, what you'll see that about this bigger, inclusive defense of democracy itself is what you'll see going.
Can I ask Blake to follow up? You know, North Carolina is at the center of a fight, specifically, you know, precisely over this kind of question. Do you think that is the argument, that if that is the embryonic Clinton argument, which I think it is, which will be the central frame for the general election, stronger together, inclusive society works better than one kind of divided by race or gender, is that a winning argument for Democrats or a losing argument?
In North Carolina?
In North Carolina and nationally.
I don't know that it is obvious enough. I mean, if your question has to do with, you know, in North Carolina, which is where a lot of the independent voters are somewhat religious still, even if they are left-leaning. I've always believed as well that the Democratic Party could do a better job of not allowing the Republican Party to co-opt religion. You know, the Republican Party's also co-opted the military. And the military, you know, I had Fort Bragg in my district, and it's one of the few precincts that I actually won as a Democrat. The military is not Republican. But the Republicans have been able to co-opt it. Republicans have been able to co-opt religion and faith and those types of moral issues more than Republicans have. And so I think that stronger together in a swing state like North Carolina the South might not be enough to beat the narrative of anti-gay rights and pro-life, which is more religious-based.
All right, over here.
Hi. So I've been a volunteer organizer of the oldest and largest Bernie support group in Los Angeles for the past year, and I have a criticism of the official campaign strategy that I'd like to run by you to see if you think it has any merit. Bernie is a movement candidate, and he did not run a movement campaign. He ran a standard Democratic Party campaign. He didn't reach out to the activists, the anti-fracking activists, the Monsanto activists, the TPP activists, to bring all these movement people into his campaign. He was phone banking to Democratic voters. He was canvassing to Democratic voters. He was using the NPG van. He was telling canvassers to go out on streets and actually bypass houses. What we did with LA for Bernie is we were going out to fast food restaurants, to Walmarts, to Targets, to places where low-income voters were, trying to bring people in that haven't voted in decades. Trump apparently brought a lot of people into the Republican Party that hadn't voted at all or in decades. Bernie did not do that.
Can we get your question? Okay.
That is my question. Do you think that critique has any merit?
I do, actually, because I think that, Bernie did help grow the Democratic Party, make no mistake about it, just in the same way that Donald Trump brought voters in. But I do think that Bernie was kind of this accidental celebrity Democratic candidate, and for good reason. But I don't think that they built an infrastructure in the campaign that was able to go out and collect all of those people who they were inspiring and get new people who they hadn't been able to talk to and bring them into the fold. She, some of those early rallies where 50, 60,000 people were going, they weren't even collecting the data from all the people who were showing up at those rallies. So to not even be able to put that into the system and use it was a real mistake.
Our clock is ticking, so you are the last question, Mr. Flash.
Thank you. You mentioned that there's an opportunity where some Republicans might try to distance themselves from Trump and sort of covertly endorse Hillary. Do you think there's an opportunity for those voters to go to Gary Johnson? And do you think that there's a chance that he reaches the threshold to get into the debates and influences the land of the selection?
Well, if you're asking me, I think the most interesting question about Gary Johnson goes back to what we were talking about before, which is Hillary Clinton's problems with young people. I think the Libertarian have a ceiling and a limit to how far they can go, but if he ran a campaign, you know, there is an audience. There's a group of young voters who do not like Hillary Clinton and do not like Donald Trump. And if he can find Libertarian arguments, particularly maybe around the legalization of marijuana, not to put too fine a point on it, that he may be able to create some mischief and create an audience in a number of states. But I think the Libertarian limit is that they, you know, if you say most Americans are economically conservative and socially liberal, and that's what Libertarians are, the problem is they take each of them to a kind of extreme that most voters can't follow. So I think they have a limit in their overall appeal, but there are a lot of young people, I think, who may be open to hearing something else this year in a way that was not true when Obama was on the ballot in 12 and 8. I mean,
in 2014, Kay Hagan lost North Carolina in large part because the Libertarian candidate went into the college towns like Boone, where Appalachian State is, Asheville, and talked and advertised legalizing marijuana. Yeah. Pulled a lot of the young people away from Kay Hagan, and Richard Burton won.
That would be a headache for Clinton, I think. Our time is up. Listen, you've been a great audience. Join me. Thank you, Mr. Burton.